More than 40 lakh people, almost as much as the population of Croatia, are possibly no longer Indian citizens. That's according to the citizens list that was released by the government today. This is an exercise that has been done for the first time since 1951 in order to check the influx of illegal migrants from Bangladesh. So let's look at the specifics. It's just over 40 lakh people who are now in that category of non-citizens. They do have a right to produce their documentation, to make an appeal, so they don't face any threat right away. But within a certain specified period of time, they do have to clarify what their status is. Now, there's a high level of security in Assam. More than 20,000 extra troops have been deployed there because the centre is worried that this is a situation that could flare up. The centre has said that the government isn't doing anything on this. Everything that has been done on the citizens register is under the orders of the Supreme Court. However, that has not prevented a political blame game from beginning, with Mamata Banerjee leading the charge. The West Bengal Chief Minister called it a policy of divide and rule. Let's take a look at a bit of the history as well and why all of this has just happened. So this National Citizens Register was actually first set up in 1951. It was set up to distinguish between Indians and East Pakistanis, what was later then Bangladesh. From 1950 to 1970, there was a surge in Assam's population. In fact, the voters went up by about 50% in 1978. There was a violent agitation against illegal immigrants from 1979 to 85. And in 1985, it led to the signing of the Assam Accord, which set 1971 as a cut-off year for illegal immigrants. Then in 2015, the Supreme Court ordered the updating of the citizens list, which is what has come out today. It is being called a draft list, which of course keeps out more than 40 lakh people.
I am joined here by one person. His entire family has made it. So let's talk to him. आपके पूरे फैमिली का नाम आ गया है नर्सी में, आप बता रहे थे मुझे. तो कैसा लग रहा है आपको जब नाम आ गया है? बहुत एंग्जाइटी थी
ना? नाम आने के बाद खुशी होता है, एनआरसी पहले अपडेट होने से यह भी खुशी का बात है. लेकिन घर का सभी का नाम नहीं है, लेकिन मेरा बड़ा भाई का नाम नहीं है यार. जो हमारा खुद एनआरसी का जो सब फॉर्म जितना फिलअप वलअप है और जितना सलाह मशवरा देना वाला वही था, लेकिन वो सब कुछ करने के बाद वो उसका नाम नहीं है यार. और वो खुद असम गवर्नमेंट रजिस्ट्रेशन का वो रिपोर्टर भी है, उसका जितना डॉक्यूमेंट्स था वो भी सबमिट किया, लेकिन सब कहा गया वो उसका नहीं है यार.
देयर यू आर, दिस जेंटलमैन सेइंग दैट व्हाइल हिज फैमिली हैज मेड इट, हिज ब्रदर्स फैमिली कुड नॉट रिमेंबर. They are from the same father, and in Assam, citizenship is decided by a linkage, by legacy. Now we'll talk to another gentleman here. He and his entire family has been left out. आपके साथ क्या हुआ? आपके फैमिली में कितने लोगों का नाम आया? आपका खुद का नाम आया कि नहीं?
मेरा पांच फैमिली है. पांच फैमिली में एक आदमी का नाम आया है, चार आदमी का नाम. मेरा एक लड़का दो लड़के का मेरा नाम नहीं आया है. मेरा बीबी का नाम आया है. मेरा छह भाई है, छह भाई में दो भाई का नाम आया है, चार भाई का नाम नहीं आया.
तो आप अभी आप नेक्स्ट प्रोसेस जो क्लेम और ऑब्जेक्शन का प्रोसेस है उसके बारे में आप जानते हैं, कैसे करना पड़ेगा, क्या करना पड़ेगा?
नहीं, इससे पहले तो मालूम था, अभी कैसे करना है हमको नहीं मालूम है, अब मालूम करना होगा.
So there you are, this gentleman, only one person from his family has made it to the list, and he is worried about what happens next, and he's not very clear as to how to go about the claim and objection verification.
Well, my colleague Ratnadeep, they're giving you a slight insight into just how chaotic all of this has actually been on the ground. And in fact, there was a full-blown political spat over it in Parliament as well. Leading the charge was West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee. Now, before we show you what happened in Parliament today, just a bit of background on the outsider politics that has played out in Assam. In the 1960s, there was the whole slogan of chasing out the Bengalis. From 1979 to 85, the students group, the AGP, led that agitation. There was the infamous Nelli massacre in February of 1983, where more than 2,000 were killed in migrants' villages by Assam tribals. And in fact, this has been an issue in every single election. When Mr. Modi was campaigning, in fact, in 2014, he had tweeted at that time, the BJP had tweeted at that time, that Bangladeshi immigrants will be sent back if the NDA comes to power.
40 lakh people delisted in Assam led to a zero productivity. There were four adjournments before the House broke up for the day, as Trinamool Congress demanded the National Register of Citizens be discussed. Even though Mamata Banerjee doesn't have a single seat in Assam, she instructed her Delhi colleagues via text messages that they needed to go big on the issue and not accept government's explanations.
Divide and rule policy korte giye, people ke isolate korte giye. It's a game plan. There are so many Hindus also, and Muslims also, and other communities also. They are very much Indian citizens. They have become refugee because of BJP government. This is absolutely vote politics and election agenda.
But Mamata's party and the opposition want a statement from the Prime Minister explaining why 40 lakh people, some with Aadhaar, have been delisted, and an amendment to the citizenship bill that will fix the issue.
ये बहुत बड़ी गलती आप लोग कर रहे हैं और फिर वहाँ पर एक बहुत बड़ा division आप करने जा रहे हैं इसीलिए मैं ये चाहता हूँ कि होम मिनिस्टर जल्द से जल्द कदम उठाए
जो एनआरसी का मामला है उसको राजनीतिकरण नहीं करना चाहिए क्योंकि माननीय सुप्रीम कोर्ट का निगरानी में ये काम चल रहा है.
However, the BJP put out this reminder of its 2014 election promise against Bangladeshi immigrants.
So this issue is likely to dominate Parliament this week, especially with Mamata Banerjee coming to Delhi and raising it with all opposition leaders, even wanting to see the Home Minister to ask about this. It actually has all the ingredients of identity politics that may be raised before 2019. The government needs to decide, will they stick to their strategy of calling it a Supreme Court direction which they're just following, or will they change their strategy? In New Delhi, Sunetra Chaudhary for NDTV.
All right, well, joining us on the program tonight is Pawan Khera, spokesperson of the Congress. Mahua Moitra of the Trinamool Congress is with us. Sanjay Hegde, Supreme Court advocate, joining us tonight. Suhas Chakma, the director of the Rights and Risks Analysis Group, which is a think tank. And Mr. Deshratan Nigam, who's a lawyer and RSS sympathizer, is here in the studio with us. Mahua Moitra, let me ask you first about Mamata Banerjee's sort of full frontal attack on this particular issue. Now, a lot of folks are going to look at this issue and say that why should anybody be living in India illegally? Isn't this something that the government should have actually done a very long time ago? And isn't it, when Mamata Banerjee says that the BJP is playing politics over this, isn't she doing exactly the same but targeting a different vote bank?
Not at all. I mean, if you're talking about legality and illegal immigration, please understand one thing, that the border, the Indo-Bangladesh border, is solely under the domain of the central government. The BSF, which is one of five central paramilitary forces, is solely responsible for people coming through the border. So when the BJP are shouting themselves hoarse that the Bengal government is responsible for people coming into the border, illegal immigrants, they don't seem to realize that they themselves are in charge of the border. That's the first thing. So we aren't in charge of the border, sir. Thank you very much. The second very important thing is, when you're talking about illegal immigration and illegal Bangladeshis, the issue in Assam is not about illegal immigrants. The issue is in Assam is about people who are Indian citizens who have been there, who have actual documents. Like, for example, today we saw that the first draft, which was there in December 2017, the rate of inclusion in the upper Assam districts where their indigenous Assamese are greater are far, far higher than that in the Barak Valley, where 40% of the Bengali speaking Barak Valley were not included in the first draft. Now, do you turn around and say that 40% of the Barak Valley are illegal immigrants? The Barak Valley was created out of 3.5 police stations during the 1947 Sylhet referendum, where the Hindu-speaking lot came to this side of Assam and the Muslim majority, according to Gopinath Bordoloi's Sylhet referendum, went to the other side. So people who have a passport today, who have the much-touted Aadhaar card of the BJP government today, are today not being part of the NRC. And that is the problem, that these are Indians who have been living in India. When somebody's been living in Assam for 150 years, they had been brought over from Bangladesh, in those days, part of India, to
You make a very important point, and I'm going to take that to Mr. Nigam in just a moment. But are you saying that Assam does not have an illegal migration problem?
Look, there is Assam before 1971. did have a migration. Obviously, that during 1971, the majority of the refugees were taken in by Assam and by Bengal. So obviously, there was a lot of immigration then. But if you see the rate of population growth since 1971, Assam, Jharkhand, Bengal, and the rest of India's rate of population growth in the last 20 years has almost been at par. Hence, the rate of population growth in Assam, which they say illegal immigration causes, is no higher. That's the first. I'm sure Assam may or may not have an illegal migration problem, and that is a problem of the central government. But what is being targeted through this NCR is not just illegal migration, but bona fide Indian citizens.
Okay,
who
so
may
let
be
me take
Bengali,
let me take what
Bengali
you're saying
Hindus
to Mr.
and
Nikam,
Bengali Muslims living in Assam.
Yeah,
that is what our problem is.
So therefore, Mr. Nikam, how does one address this issue of people with genuine documents, with Aadhaar cards, with passports, who appear to be genuine Indian citizens, now not finding their names in this list? And the government keeps saying that it is the Supreme Court order that they are following. The fact is, though, it was very much on the BJP's election manifesto and part of their agenda when coming to power.
And
so it's
fact,
not as simple as that.
I think so far as illegal migration is concerned, I think all the political parties are on the same page. Some of may do their politics. It's their right. But the fact remains that it started in 1985, if you recollect, then renewed in 2005, again by the Congress, and rightly so. I mean, they must get the credit for that. And again, done in 2015 by the Supreme Court when they set up Upamanyu Hazarika Committee. And there they realized that the question before the Supreme Court was whether the indigenous population of Supreme Court will become a minority by 2047.
Of Assam.
And therefore, they set up a committee. And one of the important findings of the committee was that the Bangladeshi people who had the Bangladeshi passport could buy the land there and contest assembly elections. This was one of the important findings of that committee, which was very surprising and shocking. And the Supreme Court went into that, you must get into this exercise as soon as possible. And therefore, this exercise has been undertaken, whether BJP gave it in the manifesto or not.
Although technically, the authorities say that they actually haven't undertaken any survey on religious lines. They haven't actually gone into how many Muslims are there, Hindus are there.
Look at the cutoff date. It is 24th March 1971.
Yes.
And 24th March 1971 was also the date for launching brutal Operation Searchlight by the Pakistan Army. And then everything started, and 26th March was the declaration of independence by Mujibur Rahman. So the migration, illegal migration, started from there. So that is why very consciously this date has been kept. And therefore,
so what about people who have documentation?
Documentation, if they have, they have a process that has been given, that you file your claims and objects, because you are in a democracy, you have a right to be heard. Then there is an appeal, and then the Supreme Court is also there finally. So it is not that the doors in the case of genuine cases is closed. One, this exercise should have been done long time back, as you rightly said, but it was not done. You have to put your foot down, because it also involves the fundamental rights and human rights of your own citizens as well.
Okay, so let me ask Mr. Chakma about that. I think in any exercise on this scale would probably have massive sort of confusion and chaos as it gets rolled out on the ground. But Mr. Nigam says, the Home Minister says, the doors are not closed. If people are genuine citizens, they have an appeals process to go through. Do you think that is going to address the concerns that you have raised about this entire exercise?
No, I think the NRC process started on a wrong premise. And Mr. Nigam is a lawyer, he would understand it. The first issue is the original inhabitants of Assam. Who are the original inhabitants of Assam? Because in 1947, when Union of India was created, you had Assamese and all the religious groups. So long you do not identify who are the original inhabitants of Assam, you are leaving it to the officials to
interpret it.
Okay. So if you have a name which sounds like Narjari, who is a Bodo, as I said yesterday, then you have to prove only up to a certain level. But if you have another name, whether it's Bhattacharya or Najrul, then you have to prove it beyond reasonable doubt. So that's the first issue. In this entire process of NRC, how many people have been identified as original inhabitants would be a critical issue. The second issue is, if people have come to India as illegal immigrants, as their parents. See, we are talking about 50 years back in 1971. So if the illegal immigration has taken place after 71 till the 80s, you would presume that these people had many children and they would be qualified as citizens by birth. because
and therefore to dismiss them.
Yes, because the Citizenship Act says anybody who is born before 1st July 1987, irrespective of the status of the parents, they are citizens by birth. It's based on that. The Chakmas of Arunachal Pradesh have been given citizenship. It's based on that that the Tibetans have been given citizenship and they are voting in Delhi, Himachal Pradesh, Karnataka, etc. So those premises.
So why do you
apply.
Think this exercise has been done? And when the government says that it's what the Supreme Court has asked us to do, that's actually true.
The Supreme Court has asked the government to do it and they had to do it. But the question is when it comes to framing the issues, the formalities, the documentary requirement, obviously it's the government which does it. So any government, I mean, I'm not blaming any particular government because this was initiated by the Congress. It's being implemented by the BJP government because they happen to be in power. If the Congress was in power, if they were directed by the Supreme Court and the Supreme Court had set the deadline, they would have still done. But what I'm saying is, if we were to do the same exercise that you prove your originality based on 1971 documents, if you do in UP, all the poor people, all the illiterate people, all the Dalits, they will not have any documents to prove. So does that mean that they are not citizens of this country?
I think that's an important point. And Pawan Khera, what exactly then is the Congress's position on this? Because it is something that was initiated by the Congress. So what are you upset about today?
Nidhi, when it was initiated, it was soon after the Assam Accord of 1985. We had roughly around 25,000 enumerators who started the work. Prafulla Kumar Mahanta was the chief minister then who expressed total satisfaction at the way things were. Then came 1997 where a new government took charge in Delhi. They ordered a renewed and intensive revision of the roles of the register. That's where some complications started. Then of course Atalji's government came, nothing happened. There were litigation. 2005 again we revived it. So there has been delay on account of litigation, on account of change of government. We are concerned about the way things are being done. It's laughable that the Vice Chancellor of Assam University, Professor Dilip Chandra Nath, does not find his name in the register today. He is certainly not an Indian. Families are being divided. Our concern also emanates from the ground reality where there is generational poverty, where there is frequent flooding, where people lose their documents, where there is illiteracy. So all these aspects, people with Aadhaar, with passport, with an election ID have lost their citizenship. So the process is something which is really worrying us. You can't leave families divided. Suddenly one part of the family is Indian and the other is not. The United Nations in June this year wrote a letter to the MEA, Minister of External Affairs, asking her, what do you propose to do with those who do not find their name in the NRC? I don't know what the response was, and that is also what worries us. What worries us most is the Citizenship Amendment Act 2016, which is currently with the Parliamentary Committee. We are waiting for what comes out of that. Why we are concerned is because of the kind of polarizing politics that is being played in this country for the last 4 years and more. Our issue also, Nidhi, is that what happens between now and the final list to these 40 lakh people? On the road, what
actually
happens to
you've
them?
Raised,
in the Hamlets,
you've raised some important
them?
Points, so
it's
you're making a
rights.
Distinction.
It's so many questions now.
You're saying that even though you guys started it, you're saying you have a problem with the way it is being implemented, the way it is progressing on the ground right now. And you raised a couple of important questions which I'd like to take up. But Sanjay Hegde, from a legal point of view, as Mr. Chakma was saying, what happens to those people who were actually born in India, let's say in 1980, 1982, 1985, etc.? What is their status today if they don't have documents?
See, the Citizenship Act provides that those who are born in India up to the Citizenship Amendment Bill Act of 2005, will be citizens by birth. Now, mere inclusion in this register or exclusion from this register is not totally determinative. Right now, of course, it's a draft. The draft will then have to be finalized. If at that stage you do not find yourself in the final NRC, then the question comes as to what appellate provisions will provide or what consequences will follow. If you are no more a citizen of India, then automatically things which will happen is that you will lose your right to vote. You will lose your right to public employment, because most of public employment goes to Indian citizens. There could be further consequences, in as much as under the foreigner's order, people are detained. Now, are you going to detain 40 lakh, or let's assume that the numbers come down? Are you going to detain 20 lakh people indefinitely? Because at the other end, there is no question of deportation, because there is no receiving state. Bangladesh is certainly not going to receive them.
Exactly.
What are you going to do at the end of this exercise is where the judiciary will be applying its mind further, and I hope the legislators are independently apply their mind.
Well,
the legislative solution would be to regularize everyone. Will they do it? I don't think
that might defeat the political purpose.
Current dispensation will do it.
Well, that might defeat the political purpose, which then does bring us to that question.
Yes,
that
this entire issue was political to begin with.
Yes, it was. Yes,
the political issue is we keep hearing about the rights of indigenous people. Decoded, it means Assam for Assamese. The question is, who is an Assamese? Is he only an Ahom? Is he a Bengali who has been there for centuries? Is he a Bengali who has come before a particular year? Is he the descendant of any Bengalis who
That it's too vague.
But
so
did
what
not
happens?
Have papers?
No. So
these are the questions.
Absolutely. So, Mr. Nigam, isn't this a genuine concern? We don't actually know what... Okay, assuming that out of these 40 lakh people, let's say 10 lakh people do produce their papers and everything is cleared, but let's say 30 lakh people are left.
No,
what happens to them?
If you look at the look at the first draft, out of 3.29 crores, only 1.9 crores were included. And then subsequently, out of 1.39, 40 lakhs have been left out, and 1 crore again have been included in the second draft. And furthermore...
What would happen at the end of this?
As
Sanjay Hegde
said. Carrying forward what Sanjay Hegde is saying, then what is a million-dollar question. There has to be a coordinated policy. You have to talk to Bangladesh about them. You have to have a policy about how to deport them and what is to be done about these people. You know, at the end of the day,
Bangladesh will turn around and say, we don't want them.
Then
what do you do?
Then you have to involve United Nations into this. You have to involve United Nations.
Mr. Chakma's
vehemently
disagrees.
No, because you can't throw them out into the sea, being humans.
I'm glad you said that.
No, nobody can throw them out. And at the end of the day, because you have a human rights, United Nations Human Rights Commission as well.
So you're saying take it to the UN, Mr. Chakma?
No, I mean, why should the UN get involved? When you deport somebody, you have to send a list. MEA has to send a list to Bangladesh. Bangladesh will verify whether that person is a citizen.
No, I'm saying only if they refuse.
Only if they accept it. So even for sending it back, you still have to go through the MEA, inform Bangladesh. Bangladesh confirms that that person is a citizen of Bangladesh. They accept it. Please understand, there are 93,000 Bangladeshis in European Union. And European Union has set up a working group, have been putting tremendous amount of pressure, where it's much easier to identify who comes from where.
But can I...
They
can
have
I,
not been able to send
no,
them back.
No, but can I ask you about
my presumption
about
is that
political
suppose
motives
Bangladesh
here.
Refuses.
Huh.
If they don't,
Bangladesh will refuse.
They will not
accept a single
then,
one.
Then it has
but can I ask you
the
about the political motivation behind this? And I'm bringing a point that Pawan Khera raised earlier. You have this citizenship amendment bill that was introduced in the Lok Sabha in 2016, by the way, by the BJP. And that basically says illegal migrants who are Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis and Christians from Afghanistan, Bangladesh and Pakistan will all be eligible for citizenship in India. So basically, except for Muslims, they can get citizenship of India. Meanwhile, you have this going on. How does one not then attribute a political motive to this, is this about targeting Muslims in Assam?
No, this is not about targeting Muslims. This is about giving a place to Hindus and Sikhs. They have no other place to go. This is the natural choice. India is the natural choice.
Not Muslims? India is not a natural choice for Muslims?
No. But why I am saying so? Because there are a large number of Muslim countries, they are not taking refugees. See, if you look at the Syria, Jordan, none of the Muslim countries took the refugees from there. They all went to Europe.
We are not Syria and Jordan.
No,
we've had Muslims
and Hindus and Christians
and all religions living together.
I am talking about refugees coming out of Syria and Jordan. I am not saying we are I'm saying the immigration that took place. And these Hindus and Sikhs were religiously persecuted in their own country.
Sure.
And therefore,
so we have
it
space
becomes
for
a
Hindu migrants, Parsi
where
migrants.
Do they go? Where do they go? Nobody
so what
else.
About Muslim migrants?
Muslim migrants can go to a lot of Muslim countries which are there.
Is India not a country for Muslims then?
No, it is. For Indian Muslims, it is.
For Indian Muslims,
it is. Yes.
But for Hindus, are all Hindus Indian? I'm trying to understand that.
No. I'm saying the ones who are coming out, it is their natural choice.
Why? They have and no why is it not a natural choice for Muslims? Because that automatically assumes that Muslims don't have a right to belong in India. Mahua, Mahua
Indian, Maitra. No. Please don't put words into my mouth.
But you're
Indian
saying
Muslims,
it's not a natural choice for Muslims.
No, certainly
India is
not. Not for Bangladeshis, not for Rohingyas.
Muslims.
See, I'm talking about Rohingyas. I'm talking about Bangladeshis.
Okay, Mahua has a point. Okay, Mahua.